Well, thank you very much, Yves, for joining us on Bite Number 5 here. How's it going?
Doing pretty good. Thanks for having me.
No problem. We really appreciate you coming on here, especially short notice. And thanks to your daughter, Grace, for figuring out the whole Chrome issue that we had going on there. But yeah, no, it's been good. We haven't talked for a while here, but it's nice to get on here and see each other and do this podcast.
Yeah, I think it was 2 years now since you were out and got on the boat. Yeah, we had a pretty special day.
Yeah, for sure. I guess we may as well hop into that kind of how we met. I guess I'll tell my side of the story here. I was up at school and I got a message one day from this sturgeon fishing page, and just kind of from what I remember, just saying that you had checked out the website and kind of liked the write up on there, and that if I was out in your area anytime to let you know, maybe we could figure something out and go out for a day. And I don't know if you maybe realized that I was the kind of person that would make it, so I was out in the area, but that's basically my side of it. And eventually ended up making a trip to Vancouver, and then I guess it was all history from there. Went out for an awesome day with Dad and you, and caught some fish.
Yeah, I think it was April, if I remember right.
Yeah,
might have been March, but. Yeah, I remember stumbling across your social media stuff, and I just started my own company. So yeah, there's something about your website, your write-up, and I just thought, I like this guy, I'm going to reach out and see if he wants to go fishing. Just funny how that works out, and here we are a couple years later.
Yeah, exactly. I think it was like late December, early January that you had messaged me, and then all of a sudden whole family was on a plane to Vancouver and we were getting up early to go fishing. So I know that was exciting. And then I guess the very first fish there was my biggest of the trip, and started out with some kind of rainy conditions, turned into some wind and snow, and not sure what you were thinking at that point, kind of what did I get myself into, these two strangers on my boat here. But yeah, no, that day was pretty special. That's one me and Dad won't be forgetting anytime soon. So I guess thanks again for that. But I guess just to kind of maybe be good for you to let the people know kind of who you are, what you're doing, and kind of I guess the whole reason that you're on here to kind of talk about the sturgeon and whatnot.
Yeah, well, obviously my name's Yves Bisson. I run my own guided sturgeon company. I've been guiding this is my 19th year. I started in 2002, which seems like a long time ago.
Yeah.
And I'm just, one of many fishing guides that turned kind of a hobby / passion into a job. And, when you first do it, you're just, doing it for the fact that you love fishing and love the outdoors, and you never dream ever that it's going to be what you do for your career. So, I mean, when I'm out even today, I just feel almost daily just lucky, blessed that this is what I get to do for a living. So yeah, very fortunate.
Yeah, for sure. And so it hasn't always been your own solo company, right?
No, I actually started with a buddy. This is going way back in 2002. A friend of mine who I used to steelhead with said, oh, I'm going to start a guided fishing company, salmon sturgeon, and would you be interested? I said, absolutely. And I had a small little 16-foot boat with an outboard motor. So if you know anything about the Fraser River here, it's a shallow, fast-moving river. You should have a jet boat, but the first year I started, I was in a little boat, 16-footer, like I said, with a prop. And I probably hit the bottom, I don't know, half a dozen times with clients. And it was, looking back, I don't know how anyone would ever want to go fishing with me, but it's kind of the journey of a lot of people starting out, right? You just learn as you go. And I did that for 2 years. And then I got asked to guide for kind of a larger company, probably the biggest freshwater company in BC at that time. So I jumped on board that, and I stayed with them for, well, up until just over 2 years ago. And I worked for them. And then about 7 years ago, I was the general manager of that company. So I took over as a guide and GM, kind of oversaw all the operations. And then, yeah, just over 2 years ago, I finally started my own company.
Okay. just in time for COVID to kind of come in there.
The timing was not good.
No.
Yeah.
So is it mostly American people that are coming up, or is there a lot of Canadians that come out with you?
Well, a typical year, I'd say it's about 60% out of country, not so much the U.S., okay. Probably 10% U.S., 50% from outside of the rest of Canada, but lots of people from the U.K., lots from Scandinavia. They love their fishing. So, and then, of course, we have local business, you know, B.C., Alberta, Saskatchewan, Manitoba. I don't get a ton from Ontario, but really it's worldwide, so... If it's not a COVID year, we're getting people from, I've had people from Russia, Sweden, Denmark, Germany, Austria, Scotland, England, everywhere. Wow. It's a very popular fishery. You're going after the largest freshwater fish in the world, right? So,
yeah, that's absolutely remarkable. Like the amount of travel that people do, right? Just to catch that one fish or chase that one, just to have that memory, right? So. I find that super remarkable. I haven't got a chance to get out there to the Fraser River. I know it's on the bucket list. I know it's on a lot of people that I talk to. We have sturgeon out here in Saskatchewan, but we just don't grow them like you guys do down there. So,
well, yours probably eat minnows and dewormers, and ours eat salmon. So it has a lot to do with the diet of the fish. Well, genetics too, but yeah, I mean, the Fraser, you know, we get millions of salmon per year coming up the river, and that's one of maybe a dozen different food sources for the fish to feed on, so they, you know, they can get big.
Yeah, for sure. I think that's one thing that's special, and with lots of the other guides out in, well, I guess anywhere, lots of, like, say, like a walleye guide here or something like that, those fish can be fished for in multiple places, whereas as yours is kind of that one treasure, right, that you have to travel for. That you can't find yourself a sturgeon guide to do the same thing maybe 2 hours from town right there.
That's right.
Pretty well got to make that trip to BC.
yeah exactly. I mean, pretty much everywhere along the Pacific Northwest, sturgeon, white sturgeon are all up and down our coast here, so they do, you know, you can get them in California, Oregon, Washington, and then of course BC. And you know, there's crazy stories you hear of them traveling in the ocean to all sorts of places. So they, you know, they can live in saltwater, which a lot of people don't know. They just think of them as a freshwater species only, but they definitely can travel through saltwater.
Okay. Huh. So would you say, like, the greatest, what would the word be, the greatest accumulation of them are in that, like, the big guys are in the BC area, or is it kind of similar as you had down?
Well, I'm a little biased, but I would say we definitely have the biggest sturgeon in the Pacific Northwest, and that's just because our Fraser River has probably the most salmon, and we're also 100% wild stock too. A lot of other rivers, you know, like the Columbia, has a hatchery program, so and they also have dams. We're undammed, so we have, you know, 1,300 kilometers of, you know, free flowing river, which is great because you need that for successful spawning. So there's a lot of factors that go into, you know, building dams. People would never have thought that would change, you know, the whole way sturgeon live and spawn. So, you know, we're very, very lucky to have what we have. I mean, crazy how big these fish get.
Yeah. So is that a zero retention in the Fraser there then? Because I know in lots of the other places in the States, it seems like you can keep maybe like your one a year or something.
Yeah, I mean, I moved here 26 years ago, and when I moved here, it was zero retention. So they had just recently, I want to say within the last 10 years, moved to 100% catch and release only. So I was never here while there was a kill fishery. I couldn't even imagine a kill fishery. You know, for me, it almost seems wrong. So even when I see something online, it just, it kind of bothers me, even though I know it's perfectly legal. It's just, it's hard to see. So, but yeah, thankful for our catch and release program.
Yeah, no, for sure. Especially, I guess, when you're guiding and you're relying on that fishery as well, right?
Totally. Yeah.
So you had mentioned that you had joined a guiding company prior to starting your own business. When you did branch off on your own, so you're specifically just sturgeon, correct?
Yeah.
So how did you make that decision?
Yeah, well, I mean, I had been in the business for a long time, and the previous company that I
Yeah.
worked for was a great company, a big company. We had like 20 guides, and after I became the GM, it was just a lot of work, after 5 years of doing it, I just thought to myself, you know what, my kids are getting older. If I'm going to work this hard and do this much, it's probably time to move on my own. And, you kind of have your own ideas, and you see kind of, a path that you want to travel on. And when you're working for someone else, you're getting paid by someone else. So
Yeah.
ultimately, it's up to them, the direction of the company. And there's nothing wrong with that. I'm very thankful for the days I spent there. But I'm also very happy where I am now. And I've made the conscious decision, one, just to fish for sturgeon, and two, to keep my company, incredibly small, to the point where I'm just the only one guiding, and
Oh, okay.
I'm not, most companies have several or even a few subcontractors or assistant guides.
Yeah.
And, I've been immersed in that world for the last, 17 years. So, for me, it's not about the quantity of trips, it's just solely the quality. And I basically try and do my 200 days a year, and yeah, if you book with me, you're gonna fish with me, and I don't have to rely on hoping someone shows up on time and kind of does the job that I want them to do. Not that
Yeah.
there's not great guides out there, there are, it's just it comes with some other details that take a lot of planning.
Yeah.
Yeah, I
And
guess
I'm
especially when, sorry, Brian, you can go.
no worries. I was just gonna say, yeah, a lot of people when when you're paying for a guided trip or you know the person behind the face of the business, right? When you're paying that much or for a guided trip and you're actually getting the experience with the person you're getting the whole package type thing, right? So, I mean, just from checking out your website and your Instagram page, it looks awesome. You got a ton of followers. Like some of the videos that I was going through your videos today, like some of those like jumps those sturgeon are doing are unbelievable. And yeah, I mean, if I know if I was paying for a trip to come out your way to catch some of the biggest fish, in the Fraser, and have yourself the face of the company there along the way, that's just kind of the full package for me. So I think that's a great route that you went with that for sure.
Yeah, well, I mean, it kind of sucks because when I'm sold out and someone phones,
Yeah.
I'm not phoning someone that I know or hiring someone else. I'm just sold out,
Yep.
and it's not easy to say no, but at the same time, it's a decision I made, and I may change at some point down the road. You never know. If Logan comes out here and moves, there'll be my next guy in line.
I just need a jet boat and I'll be there.
yeah, you just need 150 grand to buy a jet boat and
Yeah.
you're good to go. Yeah, no, I'm a lot happier that way. So, yeah. And
Sweet, yeah.
you're right about the jumping. That's another misconception. People think of sturgeon as some slow moving log that you hook on the bottom and it doesn't fight. And I encourage people all the time, just go look at the website, look at my Instagram. These fish are electric as far as the fight. Like literally, I've seen 500-pound fish come flying out of the water where I'm in shock, just
Yeah.
because it just seems so unnatural to be in a river in BC. I expect it on the ocean somewhere, maybe in Florida fishing marlin, but we
Five
have
hundred
these
pounds flying through the air.
exactly. Yeah, I mean, that'd be on the largest scale, but all I'm saying is typically the biggest ones are the ones that jump. So
Fair enough.
it's nice
I
that a
can
fish
speak from
that size
experience, yeah.
jumps. Yeah.
Oh yeah,
So some
exactly,
of
yeah.
ours obviously jump the day you're out because they don't all jump. It's up to each individual fish, but
Yeah. Have you ever had
yeah.
one jump in the boat?
I get asked that a lot. Good question. I've had
Yeah.
them hit the boat. I've had them hit the side, and I had them hit the side cradle that I use,
Yeah.
and but never in the boat. And if you've ever like if you ever come out, Brandon, you don't want to fish jumping in the boat because
Well,
that'd be the end of your boat on the inside. It'd cost you.
that's where I was going with that. I could only imagine the amount of damage that 500 pounds or 300 pounds plus, flying through the air does to a boat. But I mean, you know, if you're out there 200 days a year, I mean, there is a possibility that, you know, if it's going to happen to somebody, it probably has happened to you. So,
yeah, no, I'm hoping that doesn't. I'm always looking for the next best video where I want him to jump right beside the boat. But
yeah,
if I ever capture one coming in the boat, yeah, it'll make for a good social media.
Oh, yeah,
yeah, for sure. Blow up my TikTok again.
100%. Yeah. Do you run GoPros at all, like on all your guide trips, and just to catch like that moment if you don't have your phone out or anything like that?
You know, I don't. I'm kind of a late bloomer when it comes to tech. You know, just look at our start. And and to be quite honest, like at the end of the day, for me guiding personally, to sit down and then do it all, you know, it just seems overwhelming right now. I'm not saying I won't get there, but everything that you see on my social media is all off my iPhone. So, you know, I just hit record if it's even the right timing. Usually I'm clearing the rods after we hook out, and I miss 9 out of 10 jumps that are worth getting, you know, a great look at. But no, just an iPhone. I haven't done GoPro. Just the other reason too is I'm not that there's a lot of secrets left, but as you know, with the internet, social media, you can just learn so much. So if I'm showing everything on a GoPro, where I am, what I use, what I do, time of year, time of day, it won't be long before I don't even have that option to take people out to give them that experience. So there's kind of a fine line there between how much I can show and how much I can't. So. For me, I just look at it kind of from a business perspective. I always tell people, I'll help you. I'll help you catch fish, but not to the point where it's going to start costing me a lot of business and, you know, a lot of experiences that I want to pass on to people who are paying for it. So,
yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, yeah, everything should be looked at from a business perspective, you know, especially when it's your life, right? So,
yeah.
Yeah, I think that's one thing I definitely noticed out there is, like, obviously when doing it 200 days a year and you've been doing it for however many years, you obviously get into, you know, what you can do and can't do at the time. So after you've got those rods popped, it's like, you know that we're in for 10 plus minutes there, right? So you can kind of get the camera ready, start taking those videos. And I was astonished with how, like, the pictures and the angles and stuff that you got and were able to send to us, like those... The pictures and video you did get when you were able to were incredible. So, especially just for an iPhone. So you definitely know what you're doing with that stuff. But
I don't know. I'll have to try GoPro. I don't know. I guess they're a lot better because I see everyone on YouTube using GoPros, and I'm just so used to an iPhone. It's I don't know what I'd do without it.
Well, definitely then for uploading it and stuff, that makes it a lot easier too. Whether it's to Instagram, Facebook, that kind of stuff. So
You get all those cameras, right? And you gotta have the time to sit down and go through all those memory cards. And if it's on a GoPro or whatever, then you gotta upload it to your computer or upload it to your phone. And honestly, looking through your Instagram and stuff, you don't need a GoPro. You're doing just fine. Like, just the experiences that you're showing, like me being never gone sturgeon fishing, I feel like I've experienced it just from some of the videos that you posted. Wow. I was like, oh my God. You know what I mean? Like, I can only imagine, Logan, you know, I bet you your dad was just having a heyday.
Dad talks about that day all the time. He's always talking about it.
Before you hopped on here, he threw the headphones on and he hopped on here and he's talking to Yves saying, oh yeah, that's the best trip I've ever been on. You know, got to get back out there. And,
Oh, that's great to hear. Yeah, well, you guys will have to come out together for sure. We'll set something up.
Yeah, absolutely. Dad made that. We've done trips up north. I've won trips to flying camps and stuff, and brought him along. And that's still the one. He's like, we got to make that an annual or like a semi-annual thing, like kind of thing. Like we got to go out there and kind of keep it a tradition kind of thing. So he's definitely into that for sure. Yeah. So I guess I could kind of talked about your company and whatnot, but I was kind of interested in what a typical day for you kind of looks like, because people show up, they hop in the boat and they're out fishing, kind of what goes on before that. And then once the clients leave, like once we pulled out from the launch and we were going back to the hotel to fall asleep right away, like kind of what are you doing?
Yeah, I know it's funny, hey, because people get on the boat and they see you drive to a spot, put the lines out, and potentially get a fish, you know. It seems pretty easy, but you know, I often think to myself, you know, you're not paying so much for that, but you might be paying for the 20 years of grinding it out and learning all this stuff. So typical day, I mean, most of my trips start at 8 a.m. Alarm clock usually goes off at 5:15, 5:30 for me. There's a lot of prep work, and it depends. A lot of mornings you're going out and you're catching little bait fish, or you know, you're just preparing, you're thawing your bait each day, getting ready for the day. You know, typically if a trip starts at 8, I'm at the boat ramp at 7, you know, getting ready, retying leaders, gear, cleaning the boat. You know, as a guide, fishing is just so much different than, you know, what I grew up doing, where I would just a fisherman, you know. Fishermen and a guide are just worlds apart. I can't even explain it. So, you know, you have to make that particular day the best experience ever for that client on that day. It doesn't matter if it's day one, 100, or 200. You know, they don't care if it's windy, what the barometer's doing. And so even mentally, you know, there's just a lot that goes into making a day successful. So, you know, typically our fishery's pretty good because I always say the fish are there, it's my job to make them bite. That's why I chose not to even get involved in other fisheries like salmon fishing, just because a lot of times they're not even there. They're not in the river, I can't catch them. So, with sturgeon, they're always there, and yeah, some days are tougher than others. But yeah, a typical day is just you know, making sure that you have great bait, you're prepared, you got good equipment, and you know, after the day's done, yeah, it's just you know, the same thing. Put the gear away, get home, unhook the boat, put the waders out, dry them out, put the bait away. You know. Eat, sleep, and repeat. But it is, I don't want to make it sound like it's not great, because it is. I wouldn't want any other job, and I love it. But you know, I look at it as a job, and it just happens to be the most passionate, or one of the most passionate things that I could do. Like I love fishing since I was a kid. I actually grew up fishing what you guys do, you know, fishing pike and walleye and perch, and you know, that was me when I was a little kid, you know, using a hand ice auger on a milk crate because I was so short. To... And that's when I bought one. The first, you know, I used to axe open the holes when I was real young. And yeah, so it's just interesting how your life, you know, takes you in a direction you never know. I don't think any person who guides really thinks they're going to be a guide. You know, when they're growing up, they love fishing, but you don't know you're actually going to be a guide. So for me, it was like, you know, it was a passion, it was a hobby, and yeah, turned into my career.
Yeah, that's one thing that I, at any time someone asks me about it or I'm talking about it, the one thing I always say is, like, when you're talking about passion and whatnot, that you're the most dialed in human I've ever seen when it comes to fishing, and then the most passionate about it too. Like, you're almost more excited than we are, which I didn't know it was impossible to catch that fish. Like every single fish is just, it seems like it's something new for you, even though you've caught thousands of them, right? It's just, I think that's a big thing, is it never gets old for you, it seems like, so.
I think looking at your website, you've tagged over 15,000 sturgeon. Is that correct?
Well, that would be recorded. So,
Oh, okay.
yeah, tagging is a little bit different. So, ones that aren't tagged, obviously, we're going to record, or we're going to tag. So, but I have a scanner that I use. So, every single sturgeon that gets brought in the boat, we scan it to see if it has a pit tag. And if it doesn't, then we tag it ourselves. So I started on that tagging program in 2004. And then, yeah, I was around almost 16,000 when I started my company. And I averaged just over 1,000 fish a year. So I'm, yeah, probably close to 19,000 sturgeon that I've put the scanner over now. So it's,
So you're
it
the sturgeon
seems,
whisperer.
well, I don't know about that, but I've seen a lot of sturgeon. Yeah, I've definitely seen a lot of sturgeon.
Yeah, so I guess what did you say, 1,000 a year? So 1,000 fish a year at 200 days per year. People can do the math there.
Yeah,
pretty good numbers for sturgeon, especially.
200 is kind of the max trips that I'm doing. You know, the first few years that I started, I only started with the first 2 years I worked for my buddy Chris. Boy, I did 30 to 60 trips those first 2 years, and then the next few years I did about 60 to 100, and then 100 to 130, 40. And then, you know, I was getting up into the 160, 180, and then, you know, kind of a goal for me is to get to around 220, 230. But, you know, with COVID here last year and obviously this year, it's been reduced. So, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. So with COVID and everything, how has that kind of affected, you know, your business? Have you still been able, I'm not too familiar with what BC has going on for regulations mm-hmm. through this all. Have you been able to? You know, do gutted trips throughout this whole thing, or kind of what have you been up to through COVID here?
Yeah, well, that's a good question. When it initially started in March of last year, actually almost to the day, yep. I had some guys from Alberta here that usually come out twice a year, and it was right on the cusp of everything going down. So literally, while they were here, you know, airports or airlines were starting to say, okay, last flights, get home. And we were actually shut down kind of, I want to say around the, 20th to 25th of March. And we kind of followed the same guidelines as, say, a restaurant. So a year ago, a lot of the restaurants in BC closed.
Yeah.
And we shut down as well. And we didn't reopen until, I want to say, early June.
Okay.
So lost a few months there, and like a lot of people, they were kind of, you know, freaked out and weren't sure even when it opened. Not a lot of people were traveling or doing much, and then July kind of hit, warm weather, and people started getting out. So I was busy pretty much every day from middle to end of June to about middle of November, and then BC put a notice out saying they didn't want people from different households to be together.
Yeah,
it's not good for business.
No.
So technically I was open, and I love fishing through the winter. It's probably my favorite time to guide and fish, and it slowed right down from middle of November to basically 10 days ago, I think our province came out or a week ago and said, okay, small gatherings up to 10. And that's big, right? That means yep. I can get a group of people on the boat. And I don't mix groups, so it's always people within the same bubble. So
yeah.
So that's a real positive. So now trips are rolling in. It's back to being busy, but not like, you know, we still need to get the border open, right? Because,
yeah.
You know, almost the whole late summer and fall is all pre-booked stuff from people from outside Canada, so... Yeah, we'll see if it actually opens.
So yeah. So when you kind of were shut down there, was that just obviously you wanted to get back going, but you can't, with the laws like that, you can't do much. So were you doing some recreational fishing, or are you just hanging out, or what did you do to fill your time there?
Changing all the spools.
Yeah. Yeah, I cleaned the boat real good. Watched a lot of Netflix. I ripped through Tiger King.
Twice.
Yeah. No, I actually, you know what, when it first started, I remember thinking, it's gonna be a week or two or a month or two. So I really, you know, wasn't thinking long term at the time. You know, I just kind of thought, this is no biggie, it'll kind of pass by. And I didn't do a lot of recreational fishing. That's actually when I kind of started focusing more on my social media. I thought, I got a lot of time now. I'm going to try, you know, posting more, and started TikTok and,
yeah.
and just kind of honed in on some of that stuff and took advantage of just the time with my family too, because as a guide, you know, when you work almost every day, you know, it's tough on family life. So it was actually a much needed break and just time to reflect, and, in some ways, it was actually really good. Yeah,
I bet. Well, I remember you saying that on the boat, that the backlog of photos and videos and stuff that you have was just ridiculous. So if you had time there to get the socials going and do a big dump of all the content, that would work out really well.
Yeah.
Well, sure. I was just going to say that's not a bad way at all to take advantage of that downtime, because I mean, let's be honest, a lot of people are spending their days scrolling through social media during COVID. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of people out there that love watching big fish videos and photos. And, you know, I was scrolling through your stuff online today, and you know, you have over 10,000, you almost have 11,000 followers on Instagram, and I'm going through your content. I'm watching like everything, and all of a sudden I just stopped and I was like, man, yeah, he really hasn't posted a whole lot, but geez, people love this stuff. Like you've been doing a pretty good job for, you know, just in the last year, taking your, you know, social media a little more seriously. Bravo to you. So
thank you.
I mean, if you keep up with that, I mean, you know, your business obviously flourishes as it is just because of, you know, the world renowned fishery that you have there.
Yeah.
But you know, the more interaction that you have on social media, I can only imagine, you know, you might be hiring a couple people in a year or two.
We'll see.
I know Logan would be happy to.
After my day out there, I was just like, that's what I want to do. This is what I'm going to do. It's just like, it was total like change. And I was like, yeah. Like,
it's just, and here we are. All. Here we are.
Now we're podcasters.
Yeah. nowhere near BC.
No. We're in the southern prairies here.
Hey, I would do almost anything to catch a walleye, man. I grew up fishing those. It's funny because, you know, my best memories, you know, growing up, like you say, your trip was all about the Fraser memories. And all I remember is wanting to be like my uncle. And he grew up on the Winnipeg River and would fish in these walleye tournaments in the fall. And, you know, just, you know, the size of walleye they get there is unreal. Yeah. And, all I wanted to do was fish with this guy, because he's a bit of a local legend out there. And I never got the opportunity, but I did fish in a couple of those tournaments, and I look back and I go, man, I'd do anything to go fish walleye, you know, in a tournament. Like, that's all I could think about.
I guess it's just lots of perspective, right? Like, we're thinking, man, it'd be so sweet to be out there on the river catching salmon, catching sturgeon, and then total flip side. It's just what you're used to, I guess, right?
Yeah, totally. Yeah, I miss walleye fishing, so...
That kind of answers one of my questions I had floating around in my head. I was going to say, you know, obviously you're sturgeon fishing a lot of time of the year, but if you have any downtime, what are you usually fishing for? You know, if you're just going out on a day just to relax, I guess, you know, get away from the business aspect of fishing. Like, what are you chasing on a normal recreation fishing day?
Well, it's kind of changed over the years. Right now, today, if I was going to go out fishing 100%, I would be sitting on a lake still fishing, just because BC has some incredible stillwater fishing lakes in the interior for big rainbow trout. So,
yep.
Like, I love targeting the biggest sturgeon on the river. Like, that's really what I love to do, is get people that want to go try and catch the biggest fish possible. And when it comes to trout fishing, I have the same mentality. I'm not interested in numbers. I want to go find the biggest fish. And if that means I got to sit through, you know, 8-10 hours of, you know, one or two fish, I'm down. So that's what I do now. When I first moved out here, my passion was all river fishing. All I did was steelhead and salmon fish rivers. That's all I did. And, you know, I kind of quit steelheading maybe 10, 12 years ago, just kind of lost my passion for it. Although I went out a couple of weeks ago for the first time in forever. Yeah, it was pretty funny. I felt like a kid again. But you know, when I came out here, that's all I wanted. I just soaked up all the knowledge I could get on river fishing, steelhead, salmon. And that was kind of my passion. I would say steelhead primarily, but a lot of salmon fishing. So,
okay.
And then just maybe in the last kind of 5-6 years, you know, I've kind of got onto lake fishing, and it doesn't really make sense, but to me it's very similar to sturgeon fishing. Even though they're like worlds apart, it's like you're after the largest fish And although they can eat almost anything, they're really, really particular about something. So I always say for sturgeon, people always go, "Oh, they eat anything." And I'm like, "Well, I wish that were true on the days that it's tough fishing, right? Like, we can't even get a bite, and I'm supposed to be a professional guide." So yeah, they can eat anything, but they are generally keyed into something. And sometimes it's harder than others to key in. And trout fishing's like that. It's like you see a guy trolling around with a woolly bugger or a leech. Yeah, he gets the odd fish, but there's some guy off in the corner who's kind of cracked the code, and he's putting a fish in the net time after time, and you're just like, that guy's dialed in. He knows exactly what they're on that day, at that temperature, at that time. And that's why I have such, a bit of a passion for that now, because for me, I haven't cracked the code. I'm the guy freaking out when I see a guy putting fish after fish in the net. It's like takes everything in me not to row over to him and just steal his fly. So I'm talking all fly fishing. Like, it's funny, I fish, giant sturgeon, but for me, yeah, if I had a day off, fly fishing on a lake in the interior in BC all day long.
Yeah.
No cell
Interesting.
service.
There
That's
you
the
go.
best part.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, for sure. I think that would be another awesome thing to do, is to get to fish some of those lakes there. Just the species and stuff that BC has in comparison to us, they're all so neat, and so much different stuff that you can target.
Yeah.
Sweet. So I guess when we talked about earlier, you got into the tagging a little bit there when Brandon asked about or talked about how many fish had been recorded. We kind of talked before we started recording that it's a little different here in Saskatchewan. It's only your researchers that are able to tag things, but would you be able to get into kind of the difference there with, at least, I don't know if how it works for other fish, but at least the sturgeon, how guides and whatnot are able to help contribute there?
Okay. Well, I actually didn't know that about that for you guys, but 'cause when I came and started tagging, that's just how it was. But it makes sense. I mean, so our tagging program out here is a little bit different. But initially, it was the province of BC that started tagging sturgeon. This is kind of just short form, but basically, 25 years ago, a bunch of massive sturgeon washed up dead on the shores, and they didn't know why, so they kind of looked into it, and then they thought, we need to figure out what's going on. So basically, the province biologists started, trying to find out what's going on in a river. How many fish do we have? Are they healthy? Are they growing? And they were somewhat successful, but they're just not getting a lot of fish. So then they hired a guide. They thought, we should hire a guide. He probably can help us do this and do it better. And that guy did that for 3 years, and they had tremendous success with numbers and tagging fish. And then the idea was, I wonder if we pitch this to a lot of the guides, I wonder if they would get on board and kind of help give us this data. Because, it's a lot of time, effort, and money to spend getting data. It's not like it just happens. So a society was started, and they kind of ran the program and helped educate the guides on how to tag, how to measure. And, most of the guides, not all of them, thought, yeah, this is great, and they jumped on board. So now, instead of getting just a few hundred fish per year, you're getting thousands of fish per year. See, you can imagine from a numbers perspective, it's just crazy. It's like winning the lottery, having someone else collect all this data for you, and it's really costing nothing. So it's almost unheard of, really. So for the past 20 plus years, we've sampled, this is a rough guess, but I think 150 to 200,000 samples, and we've tagged close to 75,000 sturgeon. So it's an overwhelming database of information. So when they say, we feel that there's X amount of fish in the river, it's based on pretty much 90, 95% chance that they're accurate because of the amount of data. So it's a great program. you know, hats off to all the guides and recreational fishermen and even First Nations to, you know, donating their time and effort to collect this data, because it's really saved our fishery. Because without it, in my opinion, the river wouldn't be open. They probably would have closed it down. They just didn't have the data. They'd probably just say, you know what, let's just shut it down. But now we're able to say there's X amount of fish. The mortality rate on a rod and reel caught sturgeon is 0.012%. So basically nothing. And combine that with a new handling practice, which wasn't even in place when I started guiding, it makes for the perfect catch and release fishery. Not to mention it brings in, I think, $30 to $50 million of revenue into our economy. So you can imagine people from around the world fly out, rent cars, eat. It's big business. So I've been very fortunate. I started in 2004, and it's kind of just part of my trip. My day is showing people that, getting them involved, kind of teaching them a little bit about, you know, the history of sturgeon and tagging. And it's a little different perspective.
So when you said the new, like, kind of catch and handle processes, are you talking about the cradle?
That's a little bit different. So the cradle just kind of came in. It is built on the side of our boats, and people are just starting to warm up to that idea. You know, fishing guides are kind of funny, right? You're just so used to things being a certain way. You know, I remember the first time they said, we're thinking about putting a sling or a cradle on the side of your boat. Right away, your head's like, well, how many fish am I going to lose? Or how many rods am I going to bust? But, you know, when you think about it, it's about the fish. So those cradles are actually a much better way to handle fish, because you're not lifting the fish out of the water. You're keeping it in the water, in the cradle. You can scan it, measure it, release it right there, take pictures. The initial handling practice started, I want to say, about 10 years ago now, where before that it was just kind of like the Wild West. I mean, when I first started guiding, I learned from, you know, the people who were in charge. And, you know, we used to haul these things into the boat, let them flop around. You know, we didn't really think much about, you know, the fish. It was just kind of like you just take it for granted, and that's how we kind of treated them. And looking back, you know, I actually feel terrible. Not that fish were dying, because through all that, we were still tagging them.
Yeah.
You know, and had there been repercussions, it would have showed up. You know, like if I brought a fish in and it flopped around, it would show up dead a week later. They would be able to correlate that to the day I tagged it. There's still no mortality, but that's not the point. The point is we want to handle them in the best possible manner to make sure that they're, you know, safe and aren't going to sustain any injuries or have anything go wrong during the process. So now when you come on with a guide, we're all aware of those handling practices. And what that is basically any fish 4 feet, 4.5 feet or larger, we don't lift out of the water. We keep it in the water. Anything under, we're allowed to lift up out of the water, and that's just because it's not a mature fish. So you're not moving around any, you know, organs, or it's not sexually mature, so there's no chance of harming it. And, you know, I remember back, we used to tie a rope around the tail when we landed a big monster. You'd go to shore and put a, you know, a noose around the tail and tie it off to your boat. And, you know, you almost feel guilty talking about it, but you know, you learn through kind of trial and error, and you know, with the handling practice now, and just knowing how strong these fish are, that's why, you know, it's such a, you know, hardy fish, you know, and why the mortality rate is almost zero.
Yeah, and I think that the biggest thing is that it does. I can see how I can tell just you talking about it, it's kind of like you hate that you used to do it that way, but the big thing is how much has changed. And I guess for people that haven't seen the cradle, I guess the best way to explain it is is when that fish comes up, you can just take the line and bring it right up along there. It's still in the water, it can still breathe, whatnot, and the fish never moved in there. They were so calm, they weren't thrashing around or anything. And just you that's where you can get your length, your girth, and do you see if it has a tag in it or not. So it definitely makes things a lot easier, because I could only imagine trying to deal with one of those big 8-foot fish at the side of the boat, trying to get that information and whatnot, or going by a beach and trying to do it there. So, and the nice thing is you don't have to go to a beach to deal with it. You can deal with it right in the sling there and not have to anchor up or anything, right?
That's right, yeah. And we still go to shore for pictures, but a lot of the collecting the data is done in the sling, you know, where the fish is, like you say, it's generally still. You can get accurate measurements, you know, when it's on the shore. You know, people tend to pull it up onto shore too shallow, and mm-hmm. and you know, they thrash around, and it's just a much better handling practice this way. And yeah, you know, things have changed so much over the years. It's great. Like, I love it. And there's just so much more awareness now, so that, you know, when people look at, you know, any guide's website, you know, those fish are kept in the water. You know, people are seeing firsthand how to handle these fish, which is really important, because we don't want people, you know, going out there and hauling some fish onto a sandy beach. It's just not good for the fish. So,
and I guess, and not that you want to do it, but the way you are explaining it to me is those fish don't get that big and that old by being fragile, right? Like, the fish are very hardy and they can withstand a lot, but on the other end of that, why make them go through anything harder than they have to, right? Like, it's fishing, you're catching the fish, you're fighting the fish, but that what you do when you have them in your hands, that's the important part. So why not treat them as well as you can?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, so I guess we've had you for just about an hour here.
Oh, wow.
Time flies with these things.
That went quick, man. We didn't even get into any of the good stuff.
What?
I'm joking. I thought there was going to be craziest thing that happened on your boat. And, you know, what's the biggest fish you've caught? What's fish?
We're not even to the Q&A section yet.
Oh, wow. Okay, let's get there.
That's what we were thinking.
Yeah, there might
be
a few.
You the generic ones, but
there might be a few of those here. Like, we, you might have seen that we threw that up on our social media. And if you have a question for Eve, you know, drop it here, and if we get the opportunity, we'll pass it along to you and see what kind of answers you have. But yeah, one of my questions before we get into some other people's answers is our questions is, so sturgeon can live up to what, 150 years old? Like, they're a, you know, a historic, you know, fish. You know, do you have any type of idea what on average, you know, the age per length? So if you're catching on average 4 to 5 foot sturgeon, how old necessarily would those fish be?
There's a chart.
Yeah, there is a chart. That's a great question, though. I get asked it almost every day. And basically, I would say aging them up to, say, 7 feet is I would say mostly accurate. After that, when they get into that large category, you know, every fish kind of grows differently. You know, some grow very, very slowly after that, and some continue to grow at a good pace. But like, for example, a 5-foot fish would be roughly, let's just say, 20 years old.
Okay.
An 8-foot fish, they don't even put an age on the chart. It could be anywhere from, say, 40 to 60 years old, potentially, even 70, in my opinion. So, you know, when they're small, they grow quickly.
Yeah.
And when they're large, they grow a lot slower. And they know that because of our tagging program. You think of all the journal entries, the data entries of every single fish, for example, that Logan might have caught one, say, 7 feet, you know, when it was tagged. They know that fish was tagged 10 years ago, and it might have grown, you know, 30 centimeters in 10 years. So they know, okay, grows roughly 3 centimeters a year. Whereas when you catch a fish at 2 feet, it's more likely to grow 5 to 10 centimeters a year at that age.
Gotcha.
So, right.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's one of the things that was pretty cool was, I won't say lengths, but let's just say they didn't know the age probably of two of me and Dad's fish. But, the fact that neither of them were tagged yet. Right.
I can't remember, but that would
be
pretty awesome.
I know
awesome.
Mine for sure wasn't, but
okay.
I wasn't sure about Dad's. I can't remember if his was or not, but I know we got to tag a couple that day, but I remember you saying just the fact that a fish, that first one we had there, a fish of that size that hadn't been tagged yet was pretty crazy. So that was definitely a cool experience getting to tag that one.
Yeah, he's probably done 400 trips since you, Logan.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm not expecting him to remember that.
Well, no, I remember the day. It's just as far as tagging the fish, I don't remember. But it is rare to get a large fish that's untagged. And I only say that because the data says that. So, like, of the larger fish, like, say, fish over 4 feet, you know, we're at about 80 to 90% recapture rate. So if you catch 10 of those, you know, you're going to possibly tag one, maybe two. Whereas if you catch fish in the smaller size range, like today I was out collecting data on juvenile sturgeon, I was tagging 70% of them because they're smaller. They're just getting into the system, right? So we're the first ones kind of on them. So those big ones, they're getting less and less. It's harder and harder to find those big ones to tag, which is great because even if you find a big one and it's tagged, to me, it's still a success story. It still says, listen, this fish was caught X amount of years ago. It's still growing, still healthy, and you're able to enjoy it today.
Yeah, exactly. I guess we could hop into the Q&A now. Mm-hmm. Did you want to go first, Brandon?
Sure. Yeah, I can fire off a question here. So this one is from Liam, and one of his questions, I guess, I don't know how, you know, insightful you are on Saskatchewan here, but he's asking for tips for anglers that want to target lake sturgeon.
I would want to know what is in the river. To me, that's for sturgeon, that is the number one thing. What is the food source in the river? Because I guarantee you whatever's in that river is what they're going to be feeding on. So a lot like lake fishing for trout, like I said, and sturgeon fishing here on the Fraser, your best success is always bait from the river. So can I catch sturgeon on other baits? Absolutely. But again, they're not keyed into it, and it's never the number one bait. It's kind of like you can. So if I'm in Saskatchewan and I'm trying to catch fish, in a river, I would look, you know, do you have shiners? Do you have dew worms? Is there crayfish? You know, what's the bug life? And then I would try and emulate it. And that's where I would start. I'd probably start with dew worms, night crawlers.
Yeah.
There you go.
They, you know, that's kind of a universal bait, but I'll tell you something. I've caught hundreds of fish on night crawlers, sturgeon.
And so big sturgeon.
That's the thing. I've caught medium size sturgeon. So okay. I find that the diet is very specific for the largest fish and where you fish from. But that's another, that'll be our next.
It's an offline topic.
Yeah. that'll be our next podcast.
Yeah. Okay. Well, and I think the big thing for people here is more just, it's not even, when you're going with you're obviously always hoping, anytime you go fishing, you're hoping for a good sized fish. But I think here it's more even just hooking into a sturgeon is what lots of people are interested in, because like out by you obviously have the huge ones, right? So there's maybe comes more expectations with that, whereas here I think people would just be happy to hook into one. So the fact like of using the worms, I don't think, like if that's what they're going to be eating, if I were to catch a sturgeon in Saskatchewan, I'd be happy if it was a little 1 foot sturgeon, whether it was 1 foot up to like 4 or 5 feet. Like I'd be pumped either way, right? But I think the expectations for size at least would be lower here for the average person going out, kind of thing.
So you guys have lake sturgeon in your rivers there?
Yeah,
and you're allowed to fish for them.
Yes.
Okay.
It's. I'm very unaware of the ruling on that. Like they're definitely caught. But the thing I was going to ask, kind of adding on to this, is like, we have a lot of other like species. It's almost like, a sturgeon could be like a bycatch, right? So lots of the people fishing the rivers, there's not really, well, especially for sturgeon, not much around me and Brandon, but more in the Saskatoon area and that river there. You get your sturgeon there, but you also have however many different species of sucker. You have walleye. Like there's so many other things that could end up taking it. But for you, at least maybe you notice it more when you're targeting the juvenile sturgeon, but do you run into much bycatch or anything like that?
We do a little bit. Our biggest bycatch would be pike minnow, not to be confused with pike. It's just a name that they made for a little bait fish out here. And, it kind of looks like a sucker kind of thing.
Yeah.
They're all over the bottom of the river, and especially at different times of the year, and little sculpin, and those would be the two bycatch. But generally our hooks are big. We're using 8-0s to 10-0s. So the mouth doesn't even really fit over top of the hook. So although your rod's moving all day long with these things, you know, nibbling away at the bait, when a sturgeon comes, it's just going to push it out of the way. So it's not like it's a big deal where we're reeling these things up all day long and then hoping for, you know, that we can just get, you know, a time where they're not bothering it. It doesn't work like that here, which is nice. So thinking about it, you know, for using dew worms, that might be the worst thing, because, you know, maybe you're catching another fish all day, or you're using $50 worth of dew worms in a day because there's so many other species biting it. So
yeah, exactly. I think that's the big thing here. Like, guys have their sturgeon spots, but so many times, I just looked it up, and September 4th, 2017, it says it was made illegal to target sturgeon in the province of Saskatchewan.
Well, there you go.
But the issue with it is they're most often caught using techniques one would use to fish most river species. So lots of times it's on the pickerel rig and stuff like that.
Right.
So I guess that's what I was going to say is the thing is lots of time you, even if, like, say you've got a couple worms on your hook there, you got a big bundle, kind of a big buffet down there, all the other fish down there could still take it, and so you might run into that bycatch a lot more than you do finding yourself in BC there. So
I guess
the next one here, what should I ask here? Well, I guess we'll go into Nathan here asks, what is the biggest sturgeon you have ever caught while you were out guiding? So I guess maybe we'll go the biggest that you've ever caught personally, and then I know you don't like to talk size a lot or for expectation, but, like, what's the biggest you've had in your boat? Or not in your boat, but caught by your boat.
Well, myself, I don't even know. Like I don't go sturgeon fishing for adult sturgeon, well, too often. It's pretty rare, although I did it yesterday in the morning before a trip. when I do it, it's always for juvenile fish. The problem with fishing by yourself for sturgeon is it's an absolute gong show if you hook a big one. Yeah. You know, you got to fight the fish, rip the anchor up, drive the boat while fighting it, and our boat's 23 feet long. Like, it doesn't even make sense. So I guess myself, I've maybe caught one around 8 feet would maybe be my biggest. Guiding, my biggest is 11'4", so 344 centimeters. I've caught a few just over that 11-foot range. But you got to think, that's out of, you know, 19,000 fish. So,
yeah,
you know, it's hard to get those monsters. But I got to be honest, that, you know, every day I go out, those big ones live in your head, right? So you're always you're always hoping that you run into that fish. And, you know, we measure to the fork of the tail, not the tip of the tail. So I know in the States, they measure the full length of the fish. So we lose on a sturgeon, if you've ever seen their tails, they're super long. Like, I've seen fish that are 8 feet, and if you measure to the end of the tail, it's, you know, 9'2", 9'3". So all my measurements are always to the fork of the tail. So 11'4" is the longest that I've landed. And that fish was not tagged. I got to tag that.
Oh, wow.
And, and I fished that area. It's probably around where we were, Logan. And, you know, I caught that fish, I think, 3 years ago or 4 years ago. And, you know, everyone thinks these fish get caught every day or every week. And it's not. Like, the chances of finding that fish again, you know, are probably, if I had to guess, it'd be 1% or 2%. Like,
yeah.
These big fish are super, super smart, and they're elusive. And, you know, it's just like, once you hook them, it's like they just gain the knowledge, you know. And when they're smaller, I always say they're kind of dumb. They're like kids and teenagers, you know. They'll bite again, and then eventually, you know, they kind of figure things out. So, but I'm always hoping for bigger. But to give you an idea, in our tagging program, over 20 years and 75,000 tag sturgeon, the largest tag sturgeon is 11'4.5". So, you know, although people want to say, oh, there's 12 and 13 and 14 footers, there may be, And I've hooked some that, you know, I think could potentially be bigger for sure. But in the tagging program of 75,000, right around that 11.5 foot range, a little bit under, is the largest tagged fish on the river.
Yeah, and that's what I kind of want to make mention of it there when you said you measure to the fork, because I think it was not long after Dad and I left and we had gone on the trip with you there that this kind of story went viral about this huge sturgeon being caught, and then I instantly thought, I wonder if that was to the fork, or I wonder if it was to the tip of the tail, and I was like, whatever, like they're having fun with it kind of thing, right?
Yeah.
I think that that's what you need in science, is kind of that standardized method, right? So
that's right.
That's definitely, because yeah, the tails on the fish were totally different on every single one we caught. Like the way the top one would, the top part of the back come up, like that was crazy how much length that would add if you went to there.
Yeah, it's typically more than a foot on a fish over say 9-10 feet. So, and you know, I look at it totally different than most people. So, you know, I'm always trying to get the most accurate measurement, not the longest. Right. So because I'm collecting data and I understand how important it is to make that as you know, as tight of a measurement as possible, right? Because they're using it for science. So it does no good to stretch the tape in that situation. It's you know, it's misleading and it's not good data. So, you know, that's why on these bigger fish, I usually measure them 3 to 6 times, and I'll almost always take the shortest measurement or within 1 centimeter of that. So,
yeah,
you know, every once in a while, I see a guy tugging the tape measure a little long on his side.
Yeah.
What he doesn't know is I always take off on my end when I see that. So,
yeah. And I guess if they really want, like, you can get your measurement. You'd be like, hey, you want to know how long this was? We'll take it to the tail, and you could tell your buddies it was half a foot longer than it actually is.
Yeah, I never do that, but they do that on their own anyways.
Yeah, yeah, it's already gaining a foot by the time they've left the boat and yeah. going home. So,
yeah, totally.
Yeah. That's so awesome.
Brandon, you got one?
Is it my turn here? Yeah. What is the best season for sturgeon?
Great question. Sorry,
before you get into that, I guess lots of people might not realize this is a year-round thing for you, right?
Well, for me it is. So, yeah. So a lot of guides just operate, you know, when the fishing's good or when it suits them, or, you know, most people kind of start beginning of April and go to, let's say, early November. And the peak seasons typically are April, May, because the fish are just starting to feed again on hooligans. It's a little bait fish that comes into the river. The fishing really gets good. And then we get salmon runs, and there's lots going on. Pike minnows, all sorts of ditch eels, lamprey eels, all sorts of bait in the river. But these fish are totally accessible 12 months of the year. Like, I had one of my best days 2 weeks ago. And we had a phenomenal day yesterday. And yep. You know, it's cold, it's wet, the river's low, they're here all year. So I tell people, you show up, I'll catch a fish, and I'll catch a big fish. But here's the thing, it's not easy all 12 months, but it's obtainable. Like, okay. I would say June is a tough month because our river rises, you know, 15-20 feet higher. You know, it's freshet, the river's muddy, there's trees flowing down. Well, in 2020, my biggest fish came in June. So, you know, any month could be your best month, in my opinion. But if you're not out fishing in those months, you're not going to say they're great, you know. I mean, I used to think the winter was horrible, meaning November through March.
Yeah.
Now it's my favorite 4 months to fish.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's... Yeah, I would say for me personally, there is no favorite month. I love them all. They just mean different things to me. And really, it's, you know, if you don't like cold weather and wet weather, don't come in the winter. And if you want sunny skies, then come in the summer. The fish are fish are always biting, though.
Yeah. Yeah, like that's what the day we went was. I think it was near the end of April. And maybe like April 20th or something like that. And
okay.
The fishing was... in my mind, great. And then we also we started off really windy, which had you working a little harder back there with the kicker and whatnot. But then we got it started snowing. As I was fighting the fish, I have the GoPro video. I'm fighting the fish. It starts off windy, then it's raining, then it's snowing, and then it's sunny by the end of the video. But people also don't realize you've got those fish there. But if you just look up from your rod, when you're fighting that fish, you're surrounded by mountains. And at that point, they were snow-covered mountains. And then an hour later, the sun had come out, and that had all changed and everything. So it's just, even on top of the fishing, the area that you are able to fish in is incredible as well.
Yeah, I mean, that's what's nice about, you know, running your own business is I wanted to make, you know, an effort to try and get away from the crowded areas and just take people, you know, to less fish areas and it's more scenic too. So, yeah, it's definitely where we went is kind of my favorite fishing grounds upriver there and just less people, typically bigger fish, not always. There's big fish everywhere, you know, from the ocean all the way up to Lillooet. There's big fish everywhere. But it's just nice to, you know, kind of be on your own and not have other people driving around you or parking.
Yeah, I think
we didn't have
anyone parked by us at all. Like I think we had a boat go by us when we were just kind of talking in the morning before we were fishing, and then we had one go by on the way home, and that was it. Like,
that's
there wasn't
nothing.
Many people there.
Yeah. Like some days I'm around, you know, in the busy areas, you can be around 20, 30 boats in a day. So.
Do you just have the one boat?
I do, yeah. I got a 23-foot Woolridge jet boat that I run, yeah. So
the boat is sick.
Oh, yeah. So cool. I think I've mentioned a couple times, I was just obsessed with, like, your Instagram today. I was checking out the boat, and, yeah, there was the one picture. It was a shot of your boat and the snowy mountains, and it looked like a little bit of ice on the water, and... Yeah, I think your caption was, "This is my kind of ice fishing," or something like
that.
Oh,
yeah, yeah. That was a bit of a wild one. We had a lot of ice, yeah.
Yeah, I thought that was pretty neat. It's like a little different than our ice fishing here in Saskatchewan, that's for sure. We still have 3 feet of ice, Rick.
You know? Oh, really? Wow.
And it's supposed to be plus 16 tomorrow, so.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, no, for sure. The things will be winding down here soon. I guess that kind of almost leads into... We're pretty well done with the questions there. There were some duplicates, but one thing I was wondering is when you said that you can do it 12 months of the year, we're coming into where our season ends because of the spawn. What does that look like for sturgeon? Is it going to be random times, or is it like a certain time of the year?
Great question. Yeah, it's very specific time of the year. I would say typically it's in June. So, you know, which is kind of wild because our river's at max capacity for flow. So you just got to think of what a river this size would look like at max capacity. It's basically high, it's brown, it's muddy, there's silt everywhere, there's trees everywhere. And that's when sturgeon spawn. And they're very specific on where they spawn. They typically, you know, are off in the side channels and not any areas that would even fish. And a lot of those areas are marked off for spawning too, so they're closed.
That's what I was going to ask if those were closed.
The known areas where sturgeon spawn are actually closed. Now, are there some areas where they could spawn in the main river? Sure, there are. It's a big river. It's, you know, 1,300 kilometers. They're going to do what they want, but typically they're in side channels and they're looking for certain size cobble rocks. They're broadcast spawners, so it's not like a salmon where they're covering their eggs with rocks. And I've actually done a lot of work earlier in my guiding career working with biologists, you know, trying to find areas where they do spawn. And it was kind of an eye-opener for me just to see that and learn that, understand that. And, you know, even doing acoustic tagging where we were we actually tried for a few years to catch fish, to see if we can catch spawning fish in June, to put acoustic tags in them so they could track, you know, kind of where they're traveling during that spawning time. Well, we didn't even have success catching female fish during spawning season. So they're very, very hard to get if they're actually spawning. In fact, I've actually never caught a spawning fish in my life where I've seen, you know, a fish spewing eggs or a male with sperm. So it's like they just kind of, you know, go do their thing and then feed after. So,
and they can go quite a while without feeding, right?
Oh, I've talked to one biologist who said she thinks that female spawning fish don't even feed up to 6 months to a year before they
Wow.
And that kind of made sense after we caught all these fish over 6 feet, you know, trying to find females, and we just couldn't get any. And it was just like, I think out of 130 or 40, they found just a few females with, you know, big mature eggs. And those weren't even during the June time. So it kind of makes sense what she was saying. You know, that's just, you know, I don't know if that's documented proof, but it kind of makes sense because other fish do it too. Like you think of a salmon, you know, when they come into fresh water, you can get them to bite, but they're not feeding anymore, right? Like visually, if they see something, yeah, they'll bite. But sturgeon, because they have poor eyesight, they're almost blind and they go by smell only. If they're not into feeding, what are the chances of actually catching one when they're spawning or going to spawn? So having said that, you know, the province is also potentially looking you know, closing certain areas during that time, which we're all for too. You know, if you know, we've got certain channels closed off right now, but if it means we got to shut the river down for a certain period of time just to be on the safe side, you know, I'm behind that 100%. So yeah, I'll just go fly fishing for the month of June.
Yeah, you'll take the month and go and enjoy it.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, for sure. Was there anything else that you had there, Brandon? I think we've kept Eve long enough, seeing as he already had a long day out there with the juvenile sturgeon.
Yeah, no, I think we touched on all the questions that some viewers had and a lot of questions that we had. I mean, for me, like I said, this is my sturgeon virginity. I've never made it out your way or you know, bycott any here in Saskatchewan. So this is all foreign language to me a little bit, and it's super interesting. I know not just for myself, but a lot of our listeners that are tuning in. So I know I'll be giving you a call, Eve, and making my way out west there. And I'm sure there's a lot of other people that have, you know, if they haven't heard of your business, you know, they're definitely gonna be checking you out online. So
yeah,
keep posting those jumping videos because I love those.
Yeah, I'll do my best. Like I say, I miss 9 out of 10 because I'm usually reeling the other rods in while one's jumping. But I'll get some good ones going here.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, and thank you very much for coming on short notice. Like I talked to you about coming on, but just had a cancellation, so we figured let's try and get Eve in here and get the podcast going. So no, that was really good. And thanks again to Grace for getting the Chrome figured out and whatnot. So
thanks.
Was there? I guess where can people find you on like Facebook, Instagram? You have your website, but
yeah. So the website, my URL name is FraserRiverSturgeon.com, and then my social media stuff is it's all my name, Yves Bisson Sturgeon Co., which is a mouthful.
We'll put it down in the show description below too, so anybody that wants to check him out, if you're not sure of the spelling or anything, just go down into the show notes. We'll link it there for you guys.
That's the only problem with naming your company after yourself is if it's a goofy name, then it's not great. But if anyone wants to check out the website, it's FraserRiverSturgeon.com. And then, I'll let you guys do the rest for getting people on to
see. You're on socials too.
Yeah, and you're on TikTok, eh? So
yes,
TikTok famous.
I am on TikTok. I even posted a video today. I don't post too much, so I need to do that a little more. The stories is kind of where I'm at. So usually when I'm out, it's nice. That's why I like the iPhone, because you can kind of, you know, when I'm done my trip at the end of the day, after I put the boat on the trailer and pull the plug, I usually, you know, will fire some pictures or, you know, say something about the day on the stories. And I find that, you know, works, you know, kind of lets people see what's going on. I'm fishing. Here's what we're catching and doing.
I think it definitely gives a much better insight. Like you can have your pictures of your fish, but then that connection is so much greater when they can follow along kind of what happened today and all the different stories. Cause it's not just fish pictures that you're putting on your story either. Right.
That's right. Like, anyone can have, you know, some pictures in their library and post them whenever, but stories is legit. It's day of, here's what's going on. These are real fish. This is happening right now. And I just find, you know, people are super engaged on the stories. And yeah, it's a great way. Like Instagram's easily my number one source of trips, you know, locally in Canada. And even branching out now, I'm getting more and more people messaging through Instagram and even TikTok. I remember when I started TikTok, my kids were like, "Dad, you can't go on TikTok." And I was like, "I remember you saying that about Instagram. It was only for young yep. kids." And I was late yep. on that. Like, I didn't start Instagram, well, I don't know, maybe 3 years ago, 3.5, 4 years ago.
Yeah. I was going to say, even when I came out, like, it's not, you hadn't been doing it for too long, and you've just grown exponentially since
yeah.
then.
So, and, you know, now I look back and I go, man, I wish I would have started Instagram when it was probably a lot easier to, you know, get more engagement, more followers. So when TikTok came and you see everyone looking at their phone and they're all on the same app, it's like, yeah, I don't care what you say. I'm getting out there.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. So I was going to ask this. I thought it was your girls that had maybe got you onto it, but it sounds like it was your decision to yeah. go there. I didn't know if they were running your socials
no,
or what.
No. I do everything myself. You know, they'll sometimes help me if I'm asking for a caption or something, but no, everything's done by me. They were the ones that were actually opposed to me starting up TikTok. So.
Yeah.
But they, it paid off.
Good on you. Cause I know obviously, well, you know, as far as stories go, you know, I definitely think that's the best way for a brand to create a brand, because like you said, it's a look into the behind the scenes, right? People are seeing your personality, they're creating an emotional connection with whatever content that you're putting on that day. It's not a picture from 2 weeks ago or you know, the same picture that you posted before. So I think stories is definitely the best way to create a brand. So you're doing a great job there. But yeah,
thank you.
And there's a lot of older demographic that when TikTok came out, myself included, yeah. you know,
I was out for a while there.
Yeah, I'm like, oh, I don't dance. I'm not gonna go share my content with all these 10, 12 year olds doing dances. And then, but it's the same thing with, you know, Facebook, yeah. Instagram. It's for the kids. It's for the kids. And then all of a sudden, they start incorporating business options for
right.
business pages and yada 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 and insights, etc. And you got to put your business where the eyes are. And so good on you for taking the leap of faith. And it's obviously, I mean, you know, I was looking at your TikTok. You have a ton of views. So like,
well, it's good, like, I think it's
good
like,
on you.
I followed you right from the start there. And I was like, how are these not getting more views? And then I didn't see yeah. anything from you for a bit, just because the videos just didn't come across my timeline. And then all of a sudden I see like 3 million. I was like, what?
Yeah, it's funny. Like, I still consider myself a rookie when it comes to social media. Like, I really just kind of, I do it more for me, like, just so yeah. I can show people what's going on, you know. It's not like I research or really know a lot. I just, and yeah, with TikTok, I just thought, I'm just going to throw out stuff, and you're right. You throw out what you actually think is good, and no one looks at it, and then yep. you throw out something, you go, eh, whatever, and that's the one that kind of might blow up or go viral. So it's but I have learned one thing, and that, you know, to me it's like, I want to produce good content and I want to follow good content. So, you know, if someone's posting 10, 20 times a day, you know, I just I'm sorry, unfollow. Yeah. You know, but it's important to obviously do it more than what I'm doing, but I like seeing good quality stuff too, right? Like I love looking at people's, you know, Instagram stories and their pictures and TikTok stuff. And I, you know, I'm fascinated by it. So why wouldn't other people who are outdoors and fish do the same? So, yep. yeah.
That's a fantastic perspective.
Yeah. Yeah. Very true. Well,
anyway, you probably help me, Logan, when you're out here. You're probably like, you need to get going more on social media. So
I was even still in my smaller stages there too, kind of newer stages. I still think I'm a rookie. I don't, I go and take pictures of fish I catch and I throw them up on my fishing page, but.
Well, I love your stuff, man. I'm all over it. So, I mean, it's funny cause I love the ice fishing content more than anything. I don't know why you'd think, you know, you don't want to see ice ever again, but it's just like, there's just something about ice fishing. I mean, I grew up in Alberta, you know, in a lake sitting on my belly on a plastic bag, you know, throwing eggshells down the hole trying to see fish. Like, it's just fascinating to me. So
yeah,
I'll have to come out there and do some ice fishing. Yeah.
100%.
Yeah.
Okay, guys.
100%. Sweet, I think. We've kept you long enough here. I'm sure you've probably got another early morning tomorrow, so we'll let you go here. But thank you very much for coming on. We appreciate it very much, and we'll have to talk again soon, and probably could probably do a whole another episode with stuff we didn't talk about. So we'll have to keep in touch.
Okay, guys, thanks so much for having me on. Appreciate it.
Take care.
No problem.
Okay.
So there you have it. What a fantastic person Eve is. Like, I mean, just a truly genuine guy. He's super passionate about what he does. He's super blessed and obviously doesn't take for granted what he has out there in BC on the Fraser River. If you did enjoy this episode, definitely please give it a share on social media or leave us a review on Apple Podcasts. It helps out a lot. You know, it helps us reach more anglers as well. But yeah, what did you think about that interview there with Eve Logan?
Well, I've been lucky enough to get to meet him in person, like we had mentioned, and he's no different. He's the exact same person as he was in this interview here. He's so passionate. He's so knowledgeable with everything, and just like I could talk to him for hours. Like, we talked for probably another hour afterwards after we were done recording the interview and whatnot, and just someone I could always talk to. So passionate, so friendly, and always down to talk. So definitely, I don't think it'll be the last time we have him on here, because there's still a ton of stuff we could talk about. But yeah, it was a great time.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, if you're looking to add any quality fishing gear, whether that be rods, reels, tackle, anything at all, be sure to check out our friends over at 13 Fishing Canada. You can use our promo code Weekend Warriors, so that's WKND Warriors, and you can get 15% off your entire order, which is absolutely stellar. We've had a few people send us a message on Instagram thanking us for that discount code. They are stocking up on gear for open water season. So definitely go check out 13fishing.ca. Everything will be linked down below in the show notes for you, for sure.
Yeah, and now for the big announcement here. We were talking with Eve after, and he's wanted to give back to, I guess, well, everyone's been dealing with COVID, but he kind of wanted to give back to the people. So he's decided that he wants to do, it'd be roughly a $3,000 giveaway, a sturgeon trip giveaway, a 2-day. He's going to put you up for a night and a really nice bed and breakfast there. And so that's something he wanted us to kind of mention here that he decided to do. So when this episode drops on Friday, I believe the 26th, you'll be able to head over to his Instagram and his Facebook. You'll be able to enter that giveaway and have your chance at some of the most stellar fishing that you'll ever be able to do. Definitely a giveaway. It's not one of those little giveaways like you see a lot. Like, this is a genuine, really good giveaway and really good opportunity to have an experience of a lifetime. So be sure to check that out on his socials, and we'll make sure to share that on ours as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, like any business, you know, Eve's had a lot of hoops to jump through during COVID. He's missing a lot of business from the States, and he gets a lot of business from the Europe countries, you know, overseas. He has people coming to him from Germany and Sweden, he was saying. And but he knows everybody's kind of missing out on what they have to offer there. So this is kind of his way of giving back. He wants one lucky person to be able to experience what they have to offer there. And yeah, what an unbelievable giveaway. Definitely something to check out.
Yeah, for sure. So make sure you check that out. And thanks for listening to Bite Number 5.
Thanks for tuning in to the Weekend Warriors Fishing Podcast. If you enjoyed the show, be sure to leave a review on your favorite listening platform so we can reach more anglers just like you. Find us on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube for media updates and behind-the-scenes content.